In this talk, I shall be concerned exactly with this question. What does it mean to exist in physics? The talk will be divided into a series of smaller sections, but in fact only two bigger chapters will be important. In the first chapter, I will propose a criterion which would help us to determine what does it mean to exist in physics. And in the second chapter, or bigger part, I will apply this criterion to the physical model, in which the problem of existence seems to be extremely important. What does it mean to exist in physics? Existence is an ontological issue. How then could one ask what does it mean to exist in physics? There is a general opinion that physics does not discuss the problem of existence. It simply presupposes that the subject matter of its investigation exists. But in what sense does it exist? And what about the claims of some physicists to have constructed a self-creating world model? The problem of existence is indeed an ontological issue, but the history of philosophy abounds in so many and so different ontologies that this statement means nothing until we clarify what do we mean by ontology. To clarify means to restrict the variety of possibilities to a smaller subset of our choices, and since we are asking about what does it mean to exist in physics, the natural direction of our preferences should point toward physics itself. Physics is not an ontology, but it is often interpreted in an ontological way. This seems to be justified, at least as far as the deepest results of physics are concerned, and the deepest, and at the same time the most far-reaching of its results is, that's my opinion, the method physics has elaborated in investigating the world. And since this method is so effective, it says something about the nature of the world. Namely, that the structure of the world, that in the structure of the world there is something that makes the method so effective. And this something certainly has an ontological meaning. This is essentially the standpoint so persuasively advocated by John Worrell, when he wrote, "It would be a miracle, a coincidence, or a near cosmic scale, if a theory made as many correct empirical predictions as, say, the general theory of relativity or the photon theory of light, without what that theory says about the fundamental structure of the universe being correct, or essentially, or basically correct." The only difference between my standpoint and that of Worrell's is the difference in emphasis. Worrell puts an accent on predictions, whereas I emphasize the method within which the predictions are possible. A good starting point for our analysis is Quine's famous criterion of existence. The question he faced was, which ontological commitments does a given language enforce on its user? And his celebrated answer is encapsulated in the short formulation, to be is to be the value of a variable. This means that the theory is committed to those and only those entities to which the bound variables of the theory must be capable of referring in order that the affirmations made in this theory be true.
Although in this particular place, Quine speaks about mathematical theories, his idea remains valid if the theory is replaced by any statement formulated in a language capable of being logically analyzable. And the goal of such an analysis is to disclose ontological commitments of a given statement. We look to bound variables in connection with ontology, not in order to know what there is, but in order to know what a given remark or doctrine, ours or someone else's, says there is. And this matches quite properly a problem involving language. Physical theories are expressed in a language, and Quine's criterion of existence refers to them as well. In fact, Quine, in his essay, makes many references to physical theories. However, the language of physics is very peculiar. To be precise, we should speak about the peculiar languages of various physical theories rather than about the language of physics as such. The language of a given physical theory consists of a text and mathematical formula. And both these elements are essential. In more advanced physical theories, the content of the theory is contained in its formula, and the text provides an interpretation without which the formula were at most a part of mathematics. If we aspire to conduct an analysis a la Quine, we should look for bound variables in both these layers of the language, in mathematical formula and in the text. And this, of course, would make the analysis more complicated, but still in principle possible. This would give us knowledge not about what there is, but rather about what a given theory says there is. In practice, we could use a simplified version of this approach, which I would call an exegesis of the mathematical structure of a given physical theory. To see what I have in mind, let us distinguish three types of comments or interpretations of a physical theory. First, an interpretation could be inconsistent or even contradictory with the mathematical structure of the theory. For instance, Bergson's interpretation of special relativity is in fact contradictory with the mathematical formulas of this theory. In 1922, Bergson wrote a book entitled Durée Simultanéité, Duration and Simultaneity, in which he claimed that Einstein gave false interpretation of his own theory. In fact, it turned out that it was Bergson who misunderstood mathematical formula of the special theory of relativity completely. And in this sense, his interpretation of the theory is inconsistent or even contradictory with the mathematical structure of this theory. The second kind of interpretation is when the interpretation is a neutral with respect to the mathematical structure of a given physical theory. For instance, the space-time of special relativity can be interpreted as a block universe, that is to say, as a totality of existing all at once, or it can be interpreted
us now moving forward in time. Both these interpretations can be reconciled with the mathematical structure of the theory. Also, the block universe seems to be, in a sense, more natural. And that interpretation could so closely follow the structure of the physical theory that any of its perturbation or modification would result into inconsistencies or contradictions with the theory's formulas. This I call exegesis of the structure of this theory. And a good example is provided by the interpretation of theorems on the geodesic incompleteness of space-time as space-time singularities. In the 60s of the previous century, a series of theorems was proved by several people which established geodesic incompleteness of some space-times under certain conditions. And this incompleteness was interpreted in terms of the existence of singularities in a given space-time. This is a good example of an exegesis of the mathematical structure. This is a very natural and, I would say, straightforward interpretation. Such an exegesis is a practical way, and often unconsciously done by physicists, a practical way of disclosing what a given theory says there is. Such an exegesis is nothing else but a simplified version of the analysis a la Quine. But in interpreting physical theories, we should go beyond Quine. Let's again quote from Quine. "We commit ourselves to an ontology containing numbers when we say there are prime numbers larger than a million. We commit ourselves to an ontology containing centaurs when we say that there are centaurs. And we commit ourselves to an ontology containing Pegasus when we say Pegasus is." To which ontology do we commit ourselves when we practice physics? I do not have in mind any particular physical theory or model, but rather physics as such. By asking this question, we are going beyond Quine, since we are leaving a relatively secure domain of logico-linguistic analysis. Nevertheless, we can learn from Quine to look for those elements without which doing physics would be impossible. We should look for such elements in the very method of physics. If it would be a miracle on a cosmic scale, provided theories such as the general theory of relativity or the Photon theory of light were so successful without being basically true, then the success of the physical method without its reference to what there is should be qualified as a coincidence on the mega cosmic scale. Successes of all particular physical theories hang on these ontological commitments of the method. How should we then identify the ontological commitments of the method of physics? To do this in a precise way, at least partially, paralleling the preciseness of Quine's approach, we would certainly go beyond the limits of the present talk. But on the other hand, the method of physics has been subject to so many analyses that to do this in a sketchy way does not seem to be too difficult and is quite sufficient for our purposes. Roughly speaking, a method of physics consists of the following three things.
A, a certain mathematical structure, B, a part of the aspect of the world which a given mathematical structure is supposed to model, and C, bridge rules interpreting A in terms of B. And owing to these rules, A serves as a mathematical model of B. Every particular theory or model is an implementation of this scheme. Also, making empirical predictions following from the theory or the model and testing them by confrontation with experimental data is done within the context of this scheme. Independently of it, the entire procedure would have no meaning at all. There is no need to enter now into many philosophical discussions related to the above scheme, such as how do mathematical structure exist, what is the relationship between mathematical structures and mathematical objects, and so on and so forth. All these problems are irrelevant here. What interests us at the moment is what the method of physics says there is. We are not asking about the absolute ontology of reality. We are only looking for the ontology of the universal discourse of physics, and the answer is as follows. There exist mathematical structures, a domain to which they refer, and rules establishing this reference. Without presupposing these three elements, nothing can be done in physics, or even no physics could be possible. In this part of my talk, I shall apply as an example the above interpretational proposal to a physical model. And since we are concerned with the existence problem in physics, I have chosen a model whose authors claim to have mathematically modeled the creation of the universe from nothingness. In this context, one speaks also about the quantum tunneling out of nothingness. The model was published in 1983 by James Hubble and Steve Hawking, and later on it was developed by others. In quantum field theory, there is a method due to Richard Feynman to calculate the transition probability for a quantum system to go from state A to state B. This is not a theoretical subtlety satisfying aesthetic predilections of theoretical physicists, but an essential procedure, a way of computing the dynamical evolution of a quantum system. And to do so, one must take into account all paths from the state A to the state B, and to calculate a certain integral along all the extremal value of all these integrals is related to the transition probability we want to know. This is Feynman's method, which works very well in quantum field theory. The idea of Hubble and Hawking was to transfer this strategy to the conceptual environments of quantum cosmology. But this required a chain of bold hypotheses. A state of the universe is unlike the state in quantum theory that can be visualized as a point in a space called phase space. Hartmann and Hawking assumed that the universe is spatially closed, and consequently its state at a given time can be represented as a three-dimensional surface of a hypersphere, the so-called three geometry,
equipped with suitable quantum fields. All such states of the universe are elements of a space called superspace, which is mathematically much more complicated than the usual phase space in quantum field theory. How to compute all of the possible paths from one such state to another? This is a difficult task, both from the conceptual and technical points of view. But Hubble and Hawking showed their mastery in dealing with it. In order to overcome some technical difficulties, they introduced a bold innovation, an imaginary time. That is to say, a time that acquired all properties of a fourth space dimension. All this, together with some other important simplifying assumptions, served to calculate the probability for the universe to find itself in the state B, provided it was previously in the state A. The standard tool for calculating probabilities in quantum theory is the wave function. And the wave function is defined on the space of state. Here, in the context of quantum cosmology, it must be defined on the superspace of all possible states of the universe, and is called the wave function of the universe. It is another investment of the Hubble-Hawking model that is involved in some conceptual problems, but it is indispensable for calculating transition probabilities. Hubble and Hawking went a step further. Let us assume that the state A is empty. No geometry, no free geometry, no quantum fields. What is the possibility for the universe to find itself in the state B if there was no state A? Not only these questions turns out to be meaningful, but the calculated probability for such a transition from a null state to state B could be different from zero. And exactly this allows us to speak about the quantum creation of the universe from nothing. Now we should ask, which are the ontological commitments of the Hubble-Hawking method? To answer this question, we put aside the future developments of this model and the criticism it provoked, and take into account the model as it was presented by Hubble and Hawking in the original paper. Of course, the precise analysis a la Quine should go into many technical details, which cannot be done in this talk. We must be satisfied with a rather superficial account of the problem, which, however, should be enough to grasp the main idea. What does the model say there is? Two levels of existence should be distinguished in it. The first level is that of potential existence. And the potentialities in this model are severely limited by many factors. The wave function of the universe must be a solution to a differential functional equation called the Wheeler equation. Moreover, to overcome some technical difficulties, Hubble and Hawking consider only a small subspace of the superspace called mini-superspace. Everything that goes beyond this limitation does not have even a potential existence in this model. A second level of existence is actual existence. And this is a delicate question. Since the model is a quantum model, probabilities in it play an essential role. To states of the universe before they are instantiated, we can only ascribe probability of coming into existence, and in this sense, the model's ontology admits a situation in which there is different from zero probability for some states of the universe to emerge from a non-state. At least one such possibility has been realized, and this is why the universe actually exists. We should not forget, and this is important, that we always refer to the universe as an element of the model and about its existence as presupposed by the model in the sense a la quine. Whether this model corresponds to reality, that is to say, to which degree it is verified experimentally, this is quite another story. And now we should go beyond the analysis a la quine and ask about the ontological commitments of the method of physics on which the Hartle-Hawking model is based. In agreement with what was said in the previous part of my talk, the model must assume everything without which the method of physics cannot work. That is to say, it must assume certain mathematical structure that is interpreted as a structure of the physical world, or some of its aspects. One says sometimes that the model presupposes certain laws of physics, and we may adopt this way of speaking as a simplifying convention without going into a dispute concerning the status of physical laws, their semantic denotations and so on. In the case of the Hartle-Hawking model, three collections or systems of physical laws, that is to say, mathematical structures equipped with suitable interpretations, are assumed. Firstly, laws taken from quantum field theory, such as Feynman path integrals, or the method of calculating probabilities with the help of wave function. Secondly, the laws taken from general relativity, for instance, everything related to closed cosmological models, and some approaches to quantum gravity, such as the Witt-Wheeler equation. Finally, some new mathematical tools suitably interpreted, for instance, imaginary time, that have turned out to be indispensable to make the above two kinds of laws work together. The Hartle-Hawking quantum creation model is ontologically committed to the existence of these three systems of physical laws. Without them, the model is unthinkable. And now our final question. Is the claim of Hartle and Hawking justified that they have succeeded in constructing a model of quantum creation of the universe from nothing? Assuming that their model is both mathematically and physically correct, and taking into account our a la quine analysis, we are entitled to say that in their model there is indeed a different from zero probability of the process of an emergence of the universe from nothingness to occur. But what does it mean, nothingness, in this context? Let us notice that in the mathematical structure of the model there is nothing, and rightly so, that could be interpreted as nothingness. Nothingness is outside of the moral. In this sense, nothingness is what moral says nothing about.
The heart of Hawking moral is based on a rich mathematical structure equipped with a rich physical interpretation. The moral itself, with all its structural elements, quantum creation included, is made out of this physically interpreted mathematical structure, which is far from being nothingness.
If we attempted to construct a physical moral from absolute nothing, the zero of existence, no mathematical structure, nothing to interpret, we would not be able to move one more step forward. This is why the Leibniz question, why is there something rather than nothing, so persistent? And Leibniz's short comment, for nothing is simpler and easier than something. Nothingness is simpler and easier than something. Why then is there something that is neither easy nor simple?